אוקיי, שלום לכולם, hello everybody. We are in theoretical and computational neuroscience. This is Itamar. He's a TA. So any questions you can ask him, he knows everything. Before we start, I would like to get a feeling about the audience. So many of you are LSEC students. I see Talpiot, right? Are there people who are not Talpiot and LSEC? Can you raise your hands? So where do you come from? What about you? Okay, so we have a rather diverge audience with respect to background, and therefore today I will spend most of my time boring some of you, hopefully not all of you, by providing some background in things that many of you, perhaps most of you, know about neuroscience. Starting probably from Thursday, we will do more interesting things. But before talking about the science, I will some a few administrative details. Attendance. So in principle, you have to attend the course. In practice, I don't care. As long as everything that I say here is something that you know. Homework assignments, they will be given approximately every week. They will be composed of an analytical part and a numerical part. And you'll have to submit all of them but one. Now, I'm not sure about what n will be, but it will be n minus 1 over n, where n is slightly smaller than the number of weeks. That's the plan. The course is 4-hour course. And four credit points, composed of three lectures and one, I don't know how you call it, exercise, whatever, that is supposed to be given. Yeah. And in addition, because some of you have, because of the diversity of the background of the students, we will have another hour in which that will be mostly devoted to math, reminding you things that you're already supposed to know in math. So anything that you feel uncomfortable with, Itamar will teach you. I don't know, multiplications and more advanced things in math. Now, in the Shnaton, we have 4 hours or 5 hours? Do you know? Four hours. So we need to set the fifth hour, which is going to be, as always, difficult. Probably, it will be Thursday 11. What's your plans on Thursday 11? Open your calendars. So this is mostly for I know the limitations of LSEC students, but the other students. So I think that this extra hour is not necessary for those coming from physics. Nevertheless, it would be nice and also computer science, but nevertheless, it would be nice if the hour fits everyone. So physics, computer science, Talpiot, what's your schedule on Thursday? Is 11? It's okay? Shtika kehaskama. So we'll have it on Thursday 11, this extra hour. In principle, but not always in practice, this class is recorded. I'm not sure about today. I forgot to ask Nizar. Maybe you can send him an email. Maybe we could do it now, and hopefully it will be immediately recorded. But don't count on it. So those planning not to attend, sometimes you'll be able to see me online, but not always. Lecture notes. We decided that we will have a lecture notes book for this course, and we are currently writing it. I cannot promise, but Be'ezrat Hashem, God is willing, you will have lecture notes of the course. But again, I cannot promise it. Exam. There will be an exam at the end of the year. 70% of the grade, of your grade, will be the exam grade, and 30% of the grade will be the average of your n minus 1 of the n minus 1 best homework assignments. So that's why there's n minus 1 here. Questions? Comments?
I think we should reserve the right to have a closed template exam.
Okay.
Just not commit ourselves at this point.
Okay, we will discuss it. Historically, we used to have open notebooks exams, but we will see. Syllabus. So we are going to discuss the following topics. We will start by talking about rate models of neuronal networks dynamics, and we will apply these models to understand working memory, feature selectivity, associative memory. We will move to more interesting dynamics, rate cards, and in asymmetric networks. Then we will talk about action potentials in the brain and the irregular spiking of neurons. And if we have time, we will move to higher cognitive processes like decision making and perceptual rivalry. That's the plan. Now, there are two goals of this course. One is to explain various phenomena at the level of neural activity, behavior, and computation. That's one goal. But it is second. It's a second goal. More important for me is to provide you with analytical and numerical tools in modeling neuronal networks. These are tools mostly coming from nonlinear dynamics and stochastic processes, but this is more important to me. And understanding the models explaining a particular phenomenon is interesting, but the tools are more important. Thinking about future research, the tools are more important. Questions? So if there are no more questions, I would like to start with presenting you with a short video. Those of you who know me have already seen this one, so be quiet, but I think it's an interesting one. silent movie. Any ideas? What we've just seen here? What this movie is about? A mouse in a maze. Okay. Other suggestions? I'll play it again while you're thinking about this question. So what do we see here? Sorry?
Neurofeedback,
okay. So the idea is that you control this dot using neurofeedback. More suggestions?
Maybe it's reverse and actually trying to solve a maze and moving slowly to solve it in multiple steps.
What is trying to solve a maze? An agent denoted by a dot trying to solve a maze backwards. More ideas? Suggestions? I'll give you a hint. Okay? So these are two trajectories. Color denotes time. So these are two repetitions of this thing. Two trials, if you like.
The circles are larger on the left.
No, it's just, I don't know why. You're right, but I don't know why. I've never noticed it. I think that they're larger because they wanted you to see the dot turning around here. Another hint? That's the spatial scale of the problem. So who said the mouse? You were the mouse person? Well, it's too small for a mouse. Okay, I'll give you the answer. This is the most boring thing that you'll ever see. Why is it boring? You came here to learn about the brain and about computation, and indeed, this is a maze solving by something. But this something is really boring. This is from a Journal of the American Chemical Society. That's basically what you have here is a droplet. This red thing is a droplet, and it's moving on the surface of another chemical, and there's a gradient between here and here. So just to prove that I'm not lying, which I will do throughout the course, okay, you saw? This was a droplet. So now you ask yourself, why am I wasting your time? I mean, you came to learn about the brain and about computation, and I'm showing you something in chemistry that you couldn't care less. Now, the reason that I'm doing it is, I think this is an example of a behavior that when looked from the outside, it looks like a computation. There's something interesting going on, like maze solving, perhaps neural feedback, perhaps a mouse, perhaps an agent solving a maze, I mean, all these are seem like reasonable things, and all these things have brains, and these brains have many neurons, and we would like to understand how these very intelligent brains can solve complicated things like maze. But it turns out that this is, in fact, the dynamics underlying this maze solving is, in fact, very simple. Yes. I don't know, but this has to do with the gradients, local gradients.
Why it's not a linear, the faster the beginning and so.
I don't know. Okay, so the idea is that, I'm showing you this movie to motivate you to believe that some behaviors that are rather complex, or at least look very complex, perhaps can be understood as resulting from very simple principles, very simple dynamics, as in this example. So we will not care much about droplets moving we'll not care much about surface chemistry. But we will try to understand how simple elements in the brain can give rise to complicated computations, and see whether we can use simple principles to understand them. That's the idea. That's the motivation. So we talk about the brain and the nervous system. And I know that some of you, the ELSEC students, already know everything that there is to know about neurons and the brain. But for those students that don't come from this background, I will give a short introduction, which is partially historical and partially scientific. And it's always a question where to start. I'm going to start with Descartes. It's always good to start with someone important. It makes you feel important as a follower of Descartes. So I'm going to talk about Descartes. So Descartes, to the best of my knowledge, was the first to come up with a mechanistic model of brain and learning and memory. I mean, the Greek already knew that all our thoughts, everything is in the brain. In the time of the Romans, Galen was doing experiments, doing lesions in pigs and monkeys, studying the function of different parts of the brain. There are even some claim that he was doing experiments on humans, on convicts. But the first one to come up, to the best of my knowledge, with a mechanistic model of learning and memory is Descartes. And I'd like to read some lines from his book. I shall content myself with telling you more about how the traces are imprinted on the internal part of the brain. Spirits pass through tubes, bend and arrange any fiber that they encounter in various ways, depending on the different ways in which the spirits are moving and the different openings of the tubes into which they pass. Patterns are preserved in such a way that the idea that we were previously on this gland can be formed again long afterwards without requiring the presence of the object to which they correspond. And this is what memory consists of. So the idea is that we have some spirits, whatever that means, in the brain, and we have tubes, and these spirits move along these tubes, and as they move, they can change the tubes, making it easier for future spirits to move in one trajectory or the other. And the idea of these spirits is probably older. It goes back to the ancient Greeks. And until the 19th century, this was in some way generally accepted. And towards the end of the 19th century, when people looked at these images of the brain, this is an image, if I'm not mistaken, from the cerebellum, drawn by Ramon y Cajal using a method that is known as Golgi method for staining. Well, what people saw in these images are like many fibers interconnected, a mesh of interconnected fibers, which is consistent with this idea of something that is flowing through tubes, not exactly clear what. And the dominant theory towards the end of the 19th century is known as the reticular theory. There are two important figures behind this theory. One is Joseph von Gerlach, and another one is Camillo Golgi, an Italian anatomist that won the Nobel Prize in 1906 for developing what is now known as the Golgi method for staining neurons. And basically what they believed, based on these images, is that the brain's nervous system consists of processes of contiguous cells that are fused to create a massive meshed network. So this is like basically the same idea that that Descartes had and probably Greeks before him. One of the most important revolutions in neuroscience started with Ramon y Cajal at the end of the 19th century. Ramon y Cajal, looking at these images carefully through the microscope, decided that in fact this is not a continuum, and the brain is composed of discrete elements, cells that were later called neurons, similar to the fact that the entire body is composed of cells. And this is now generally accepted. This is a nice image of neurons in the dentate gyrus. Each of these is one neuron, and the technique that I will not go into enables the coloring of each neuron using a different color. This is a brain structure that I particularly like. This is, anyone knows? This is a cerebellum. These are the beautiful Purkinje cells, and these small ones are the granular cells. These are the inhibitory neurons in the cerebellum. This is one. This is like the folia. This is one folium. And generally speaking, when we talk about neurons, as many of you know, neuron is divided, can be divided into three parts. There is the soma, you have the dendrites, and you have the axon. And the neuron receives information through the dendrites and transmits information to other neurons through these axons. And what we all believe today is known as the neuron doctrine, that was developed or postulated by this gentleman, has too long a name to read, based much on the work of Santiago Ramon y Cajal, says that the brain is made up of individual units, the neurons, which are cells similar to other tissues in the body, and these fibers that we observe are cell processes. And neurons or nerve cells are connected by sites of contact and not by continuity. So you have discrete elements in the brain. So just to get a feeling on these neurons, what's the length of the axon? Does anyone know? So the answer is which neuron? How long can an axon be? So in the human body, the longest axon is about a meter, going from the spinal cord to the legs. It has been speculated that the largest axons are axons of which animal? Whales. Basically, whales are like us, just bigger and fatter, and they know how to swim better than us, at least. And it has been estimated that the axons of a blue whale can be as long as 25 meters, which is pretty impressive. I mean, think about it, it is a single cell. Okay. So these are neurons. Any questions about neurons? This is all you need to know about neurons. And we spoke about the fact that neurons are that you have these spirits that flow through the processes of what we now know as neurons. But this theory of Descartes is obsolete now, and now we know that neurons are electrically active. Does anyone know how we know that they're electrically active? What was the first evidence that neurons are electrically active? Even before fogs. So already at the time of the Greeks, we knew something about static electricity, and sometimes towards the 18th century, people started playing with this static electricity and store this static electricity and play tricks with this static electricity. And one thing that people found was that static electricity can cause limb movement in paralyzed patients. So imagine the fun of it. You take somebody that is paralyzed, and you had these things that called, I think, Leyden glass. These were something like old batteries where static electricity would be stored, and you discharge it on the limb of a paralyzed person, and he's moving, he or she would move the limb, and beyond the fun of it, this was indicative that electricity plays an important part in something that has to do with the nervous system. And later, I think you brought it up, there was the work of Luigi Galvani that used these Leyden glasses to cause limb movement by activating the spinal cord of frogs and other animals. And one experiment was to do a similar thing rather than using static electricity, to use a lightning to activate the spinal cord of a frog and to cause contraction of the limbs. And this was actually very important for the development of electricity, because this implied that this lightning is somewhat related to this static electricity. This is something that was not known at the time. And this is an important discovery of Luigi Galvani. But today we know that neurons are electrically active. How do we know that? Well, we take a neuron, we put an electrode, a microelectrode, inside the neuron, and you see what's going on. This is an example of a recording from a Purkinje cell of a rat, these beautiful cells that I showed you previously. And what you can see is that sometimes the neuron is hyperpolarized, and from time to time you have these spikes of activity. This is by the way, a drawing of a Purkinje cell by Ramon y Cajal. Very nice. I like these cells very much. And you see these spikes that are known as action potentials, and you see it in Purkinje cells. You see it in this is a pyramidal cell in primary visual cortex. Basically, wherever you look, you see these action potentials, and one can change the rate of these action potentials by current injection, as you can see in this example. So if you inject small amount of current, you get these action potentials at a small rate. If you increase the amplitude of the current injected, the rate of these action potentials increases. So this is a property of neurons, almost all neurons. Now the question is, why are neurons electrically active at all? This is, by the way, the fact that neurons are electrically active. This is not unique to neurons. Actually, you find it in many cells. So why do cells have a membrane potential? Mechanistically. What about different ions?
You have positive ions in one part and negative in another part.
Why should you have positive ions in one part and negative ions in another part? So actually the mechanism is similar to the mechanism of a battery. So neurons have the concentration of ions inside the neuron. This concentration differs from the concentration of ions outside the neuron. So this is illustrated here. So you have outside you have more sodium, and inside you have more potassium. This by itself is not enough for potential. Because overall, both the inside and the outside are neutral.
So close to the membrane?
I'm sorry?
So close to the membrane.
Why should the difference in concentration of sodium and ion, of sodium and potassium ions, result in a membrane potential at all? So the next element that is necessary for a potential is conductance. So in the membrane, this is the membrane of the cell. You can think about a cell as a droplet of water that is coated by a lipid bilayer. And this lipid bilayer has a molecules in it which are which are permeable to specific ions. So imagine that you have such such a tunnel, if you like, that is permeable only to potassium ions. What will happen? You have a higher concentration of potassium inside than outside. So by diffusion, there will be more flow of potassium from the inside to the outside than from the outside to the inside. So as a result of this diffusion, there will be a total flux of potassium ions outside, resulting in a potential. So this is why neurons in general, most of the time, are hyperpolarized. Because of potassium conductances. The reason that why we have these action potentials is that in addition to these potassium conductances, there are also sodium conductances on the membrane, but these are interesting. These are more interesting than these potassium conductances, because these are voltage dependent. So if you depolarize the cell, then these voltage dependent sodium channels open, and then you have the opposite. You have sodium flowing from the outside to the inside of the neuron, reversing the potential. And then you have this depolarization of the cell. Within something like 1 millisecond, these voltage-dependent sodium channels close, and there is an addition of a voltage-dependent potassium channels that open, resulting in a hyperpolarization of a cell and bringing it back to levels that eventually go to the threshold level. So this is the mechanism underlying an action potential in a neuron, and you see it in almost all neurons, certainly in vertebrates is slightly more complicated, but in most neurons you see these mechanisms, and as a result you have these events, these action potentials. So now we question about the action potential and the generation of action in action potential. So now we generally believe that the neuron is a basic computational neuron, and the action potential is a basic unit of communication. The reason that we believe it is that to a large extent, the only information that one neuron knows about what's going on in another neuron is the timing of these events, the timing of these action potentials. So there are many things going on in a neuron, but the information that is transmittable is the timing of action potentials. And these action potentials are pretty stereotypic. They all look very much alike. And the only transmittable information, this is something that I've already said. Questions? Yes. Thanks for the question. It's an important thing that I forgot to say. So how come that there is a difference in the concentration of different ions, specifically if you have conductances that open and close and eventually everything should go to steady state? So the reason that you have this difference in the first place is that you have something that is known as ionic pumps. So these are small elements or molecules that use energy to move ions against the concentration, basically to put potassium in and sodium out. More questions? Okay, so how do neurons communicate with each other? So As I said, this is a neuron, and maybe I should draw it. Neurons communicate through something that is called a synapse. Synapse is a gap, a small gap between two neurons, and an action potential. That an action potential that propagates, maybe I should say another word before I talk about propagation of action potentials. So if this is a neuron, if the neuron is depolarized, there is this a stereotypic positive feedback mediated event of depolarization and then hyperpolarization that is generated about here. And the axon is an excitable element. It has these voltage-dependent ionic channels, as I discussed previously, and the depolarization here results in a depolarization here, which results in a depolarization here, and so on. So we have like a wave of activity that is propagating along the axon until it reaches the terminals of the axon. And when this depolarization reaches the terminals of the axon, what it does, it releases chemicals which are known as neurotransmitters. And these chemicals, through diffusion, move to diffuse to the ends of these dendrites, and there they change the voltage of the dendrites. And the way that they change the voltage of the dendrites is by opening, as before, opening ionic channels, changing the conductances at the end, at the tips of the dendrites, resulting in a either depolarization or hyperpolarization of the dendrite, depending on the specific conductances that that are opened as a result of the release of the neurotransmitter at the tip, at the terminal of the axon. And it's typical to divide synapses into two groups: synapses that result in depolarization, which are known as excitatory synapses, because they make the cell more likely to fire an action potential, and inhibitory synapses. These are synapses that decrease the probability that the postsynaptic neuron will fire an action potential, typically through hyperpolarization of the dendrite. And there is a law called Dale's law that says that the neurotransmitter, or the set of neurotransmitters released by a neuron, is fixed throughout its terminals. So neurons in general are either excitatory or inhibitory, and we will use this distinction in our modeling work. Something about numbers. Most neurons in the central nervous system receive thousands of synaptic inputs. The exact number differs between different types of neurons. Purkinje cells receive something like 200,000 inputs, whereas the other neurons, in other types of neurons in the cerebellum that are called granular cells, that receive only 4. So there's large diversity. Now, the activity or the potential of a neuron depends on the input that it receives from all its synapses. And so neurons do something like a spatial and temporal integration of all the activity taking place in the dendrites. A few numbers. The human brain, we have something like 10 to the 11 neurons, 10 to the 14 synapses, and something like 10 to the 6 to 10 to the 7 kilometers of wiring. These are just the axons, which are composed most of the wiring. So this is a complicated system. That's why we need mathematical modeling in order to understand it. There are many types of neurons, many thousands in the human brain. These are just examples of different types of neurons only in the retina. These neurons differ in their morphology, they differ in their physiology. But sadly enough, in our modeling work, we will ignore all this complexity and think about all neurons as identical, as having exactly the same properties. This is, of course, not true, but when we think about large networks, we need to make approximations if we want to understand what's going on. But again, this is an assumption that will be useful when we try to understand some properties of the network, but for others, we need to know the details of the neurons. Similarly, if we look more carefully at action potentials in different neurons, you see that different neurons have different action potentials. This action potential of dopaminergic neurons is pretty wide, 4 milliseconds. These pyramidal neurons, their action potential is less than one millisecond. Purkinje cell neurons, action potential is 200 microseconds. But we will ignore all this complexity and just think about one stereotypic action potential. Questions? So if there are no more questions, we'll take a break now, and after the break, we will move to talk about the motives.
שלא הגיעו בעצם סיגנלים מתאים אחרים.
כן, יש תאים שהם פייסמקרים.
מה?
פייסמקרים. פייסמקרים.
σε line began to have things that are more important. Σε τι μοντέλο δεν είναι, μόλι κόσμο. Α, το μοντέλο. Το
Thank you.
Would you like to start? So, the brain is an ugly place to be. It's really complicated. And very diverse. And there's a lot that we don't know, and there are many things that we know and we wish that we would not have known, because they just add to the complexity of the brain. The brain is also it's composed of a very large number of elements. And this requires us to make approximations. And one thing that is always a question is, what's the right level of abstraction when modeling the brain? And there's no unique answer to this question. And to a large extent, this question, the answer to this question depends on the particular question that we have in mind. So if we are interested in the role of, on the effect of branching, on branching of the dendrite on particular computation, then clearly we should take this branching into account. If we care about the role of a particular ionic channel in computation, then clearly we should take this ionic channel into account. Perhaps for other purposes, we should not care at all about neurons. So if you talk to a neurologist, they don't care about neurons. They care about areas, brain areas. That's good enough for them. So the question of the right level of abstraction is a crucial one, but there's no unique answer, and the answer depends on the particular question. Since in Lotem's course, the focus was individual neurons and the generation of action potentials and dynamics of individual neurons, and in this course we will move to thinking about networks. And when we talk about networks, we will specifically about large networks, we will ignore much of the biological details, but nevertheless we have to remember that we are making approximations. This is not reality. Reality is much more complicated. And just to show you how complicated it is, I want to show you one movie of the anatomy of the retina. I don't have control over the lights over there. Oh, I do. Good. And so this is a short movie about the retina. So what you see here, all the different colors correspond to different neurons. These tubes that the camera goes through are blood vessels in the retina. And the entire movie is of something like 10 to the minus 3 cubic millimeter, something like 1,000 neurons. See how ugly it is. Maybe beautiful, I don't know. Depends on your taste. I find it discouraging. Just too complicated. So these were 1,000 neurons. We have 10 to the 11. This was 10 to the minus 3 cubic millimeters. We have about 1,500 cubic centimeters. If you want to leave, you can leave now. Okay? So the bottom line is the brain is very complicated. We make approximations because that's the way to go. But we have to remember that these are approximations. So bear this in mind. So the first class of models that we will discuss are called rate models. These are models in which we study what determines the rate of action potentials. So why do we care about rate models? One motivation comes from experiments. So this is a classic experiment from the beginning of the 1980s. In this experiment, a monkey was trained to move this handle to one of eight possible directions. And what you see here, these are recordings of the timing of action potentials. These are called raster plots of a single neuron in the motor cortex of the monkey brain. And the different lines correspond to different repetitions in which the monkey was given exactly the same instruction. So the monkey was told to move to this direction, and in one trial, these were the times of action potentials. In another trial, these were the times of action potentials. In another third trial, these were the times of the action potential. Time zero is the time of the instruction. Sorry, time zero is the time of beginning of the initiation of the movement. I'm sorry. So there are a few things worthwhile noting. One is that you do exactly the same experiment. So you tell the monkey, move your hand in this direction. And every time, you get a different pattern of timing of action potentials. Now, this is horrible. This is horrible because we all came to study science. And one thing that is crucial in science is the fact that you can repeat an experiment and get the same results, right? So this is an example in which you repeat the same experiment and get different results. The timing of action potential is different. So the obvious answer would be, okay, you have measurement noise, right? I mean, this is biology. There's always noise in biology. So if this is true, this would imply that in newer experiments, when control is better, then these would become more reproducible. Well, it will turn out that this is not the case. So it's an interesting observation. Another thing that is worthwhile noting is that when the monkey moves its head in these directions, there was more activity on average, whereas when it moved its hand in the other directions, there was less activity. The rate of action potentials was smaller. So one way of quantifying it is to measure the rate of action potentials for different directions of movement. And then you get this nice bell curve indicating that in this direction, I don't know, this would be, 200 degrees or something like this, there will be the rate of activity, the fine rate of the neuron is higher, whereas in other directions, the fine rate of the neuron is lower. So the rate of the neurons, rather than the timing of individual spikes, are something that is modulated, or perhaps modulates, behavior. Certainly, it's correlated with behavior. So maybe it would be interesting to think about the rate of these events rather than to think about the timing of the individual action potential. Now, it's very important to me at this point that you will all understand what we see here. Because you will see these raster plots and these averages throughout the course. So are there any questions about what you see here? Yes?
Can you repeat what are the axes?
Yeah. So this is time. This is time. Different lines are different repetitions of the same experiment. And these lines are the times of action potentials of one neuron in the brain of the monkey, in this case in the motor cortex of the monkey that was recorded in this experiment. One neuron out of, I don't know, millions in this particular brain region. More questions? Yes. The initiation of movement, if I remember correctly, yes. More questions? So this is another example a different animal. This is a rodent, and the details of the task are not very important. It was presented with vertical and oriental and horizontal gratings, and had to make a decision based on them. And these are the times of the actual potentials. Every line, these are rasters, so every line is one trial. This is the function of orientations, and this is the function of the contrast of the stimulus. And again, you can see that this particular neuron is more responsive to particular orientations, maybe, I don't know, between 210 between 240 and 300, and responds more when the contrast is higher, and there's more also some activity here, 100 and something like 180 degrees from this orientation. So again, we can you can see that the timing of individual action potentials are not reproducible, despite the fact that 35 years the 35 years between the Georgopoulos experiments in the motor cortex and these experiments, so we were unable to reduce this biological noise. Which is interesting. And but still, the rate is correlated with the external world, in this case, features of the stimulus. And this is just the way that they quantified it in this experiment. This is the average fine rate as a function of contrast and as a function of, I don't remember what. The idea is that, I guess, the idea is that the way that experimentalists consider the data is often they look at the rate of events for two reasons. One is that this is something that they've been measuring for decades now, many decades now. This is something that we can measure. So the way that we model the system, to some extent, depends on the way that, depends on the tools, experimental tools that we have. This is one reason that people care about the rate, and the second that the rate can be modulated by the external world. So this is the motivation behind using rate models that study how the rate of firing rates. How the firing rate of a neuron depends on its external input. Questions? Yes?
Shouldn't there kind of just parallel lines? Shouldn't 180 and 0 be potentially the same? Like, when you oriented 180
No, because these were moving. These were moving gratings. So we have 360. But still, you see that there is the neuron cares mostly about, or to a large extent, it cares about orientation, but it also cares about the direction. If you have, if you include direction, then you have 360 degrees. More questions? But the important point here is that the timing of individual action potential, at least in the cortex, is not something that is predictable, not something that is reproducible in experiments. The rate is something that is related to the external world, and that's why we will care about models that tell us something about how the rate changes as a function of input, as a function of activity of other neurons. So let's start. We'll start with a rate model. So the standard rate model is again is an approximation, but a useful one. So I'll write down the equation. So the equation is that the derivative of the firing rate of neuron I with respect to time is equal to minus its firing rate plus a function of its input. So Ri is a measure of the firing rate of neuron I. Tau is a time constant. Time constant is a measure of the time it takes the system to respond as a result of different delays that you have in the system. Synapses take synapses time to respond, takes a memory potential time to respond to inputs. So all these would be modeled by this tau. G is also known as the FI curve. So basically, it's a function that models the firing rate of the neuron as a function of its input in a steady state. So in a steady state, when the derivative of Ri with respect to t is equal to zero, the fixed point is Ri is equal to g of hi, and g is a function that models the firing rate of the neuron as a function of its input in a steady state. So what can we say about this G function? What would be the shape of this G function? We're not talking about an action, we're talking about the firing rate. So what can we say about this function? It has to be, well, typically, we know that the more current we inject to neurons, and I've already shown you one example, the higher the firing rate. So this should be an increasing function of HI. What's the minimal firing rate of a neuron? Zero, right? A neuron cannot fire at a negative rate. And what's the maximal firing rate of a neuron? Well, we don't know. It will depend on the neuron, but a neuron will have a maximal firing rate. Yeah. I mean, even thinking about the fact that an action potential has a width, maybe 1 millisecond, implies that there has to be a maximal firing rate. Typically, this maximal firing rate will not exceed a few hundred hertz. 200 hertz would be a high value for maximal firing rate of a neuron, but it will have a maximal firing rate. So it will have a minimal firing rate, and it will have a maximal firing rate. It's an increasing function, so it should look something like, I don't know, something like this, perhaps, where this value can be, well, depending on the neuron, and the value of the slope here will be measure of the sensitivity of the neuron, and we know that the minimal value is zero, and there will be a maximum value. So often we use a logistic function to model it. We can use different functions, but often we use a logistic function to model it. Write it here. So a logistic function would be 1 plus e to the beta of x minus theta minus x to the power of minus 1. Theta minus x. I apologize for my handwriting. So this function is characterized by two parameters. One is beta, which is a measure of the slope of this sigmoid function. And another one is theta, which has a, this is like a soft threshold. So this would be theta. But in principle, in practice, we are going to use different functions throughout this course. So these functions will be chosen partially for reasons of convenience, or if we want to model a particular neuron, then we will use an appropriate an FI curve function that better fits this particular neuron that is of interest to us. Questions?
Yeah, H itself is
no. Okay. Thank you. That's a fantastic question. H is input. Okay. But now the question is, okay, G of X is a function that models the fine grade of the neuron. What's the problem? There's a problem here. Relates to your question.
We should input like G to itself, because the input is another grade.
This is something that we will worry about in a second. You're absolutely right. That this input comes from activities of other neurons. So how are we going to model it? But before that, well, what can we say about this G function? This G function goes from, what are the values that this G function attains? From 0 to 1, right? So when x is infinite, then g is 1. When x is minus infinite, g is 0. So I think we are all comfortable with the fact that when h is very, very negative, the firing rate would be 0. But why to restrict ourselves to maximal firing rate, which is equal to 1, and in what unit?
Well, because maybe the time of the reset of the...
But why 1? What's so special about 1? This G function goes to 1. So the way that we will think about this problem is that G will be a measure, we can think about the firing rate of the neuron measured relative to its maximal value. So 1, in some sense, will be the maximum value of the firing rate of the neuron. And perhaps I should have said something about this tau. So if we think about real neurons in the brain, the characteristic time of neurons is on the order of what? What's the characteristic time of the membrane potential of neurons?
10 to the minus.
In one, so usually it's longer. So the characteristic time would be on the order of 10 milliseconds. I said that this is also, it also includes the characteristic time of synapses. So some synapses are slightly longer. The time characteristic time is slightly longer. So this would be on the order of, I don't know, maybe 10, maybe 50 milliseconds. This is a time this is a characteristic time. We will often omit this tau in our analysis, and then our units of time will be tau. Okay, so this is our G function. Now HI is the input to neuron I at time t. Where shall I write it? If I write here, do you see the ones on the back? Or no? Okay, so let's do it here. So the input to neuron I at time t is equal to sum from 1 to n of jij rjt plus hi0. So the input to neuron I at time t is a sum of the activities of all presynaptic neurons for each neuron. We multiply it by the corresponding jij. Jij is the strength of the synapse from neuron j to neuron I. So if I draw it, so this would be neuron I, this would be neuron j, this would be the synapse from neuron j to neuron I, and it is denoted by jij. So that's the sum of all presynaptic neurons, the activities of all presynaptic neurons, weighted by the corresponding synapse, and plus some external input. This external input could correspond to current that we inject to this neuron in an experiment, or to other inputs to this neuron that we don't want to model as part of the network. For example, input coming from a different brain region. So these are the two equations that we will use from here on. Now, all the complexity and all the interesting things will depend on the connectivity matrix on JIJ. So different JIJs, different connectivity matrices, will result in different dynamics of the network and will perform different computations. Questions? Yes.
You said this is a model that simplifies things. What is this model simplify? Can you have explicitly what it simplifies?
Oh. We can spend 2 hours sitting and discussing the thing that this model does not capture. Well, it doesn't capture the spatial, the morphology of the neuron. It doesn't capture it assumes that the dynamics is characterized by a single time constant, whereas we know that there are many time constants associated with the dynamic. It simplifies the synapses. We think about the synapses here as something that is characterized by a single number, jij. Synapses are very complicated and clearly ugly elements in the system, and using a single number to characterize them is close to a crime against humanity.
So when can I use this model if I have my soul so much?
Well, this is similar to what we do in physics, where, I don't know, if you are interested in understanding pressure and temperature and the relationship between volume, pressure, and temperature, you often don't take into account the properties, the microscopic properties of the molecules that constitute this gas. And sometimes it works perfectly well, but for some things it's a useful approximation, but not for everything. Well, this is a very important question, but it's difficult to answer in general. This will depend on the particular question that you have in mind. Yes?
So when we model networks with this model,
yes.
So do we consider tau the same for every neuron?
Yes. I mean, written this way, you assume that you have the same tau for all neurons. More questions? So, learning in this framework will correspond to changes in the GIJs. So there is an influential theory in neuroscience that posits that we are our connectome. It posits that all the interesting information about us, humans, each of us, what makes us different from each other, is the connectivity matrix, this JJ. Whenever we learn something new, synapses change. Whenever we forget something, synapses change. So in this framework, everything that is interesting is this connectivity matrix. And indeed, in some of the models that we will discuss, we will ask ourselves, how can these synapses change as to underlie learning? Yes, you had a question. It's a good question. So if I say that JIJs can change, shouldn't JIJ be time dependent? Yes, they should. However, again, this is an approximation. We will use the idea of separation of timescales. So the time, the changes in activity in the brain are on the order of milliseconds, tens of milliseconds. Changes in connectivity can take much longer, depending on how you measure it. There are many timescales associated with learning, but many of them are much, much longer than the timescale of activity. So the idea would be that we can, if you have this separation of timescale, in principle, you can assume that these are constant while studying these, and then study the effect of these on effect of changes in these on the dynamics of activity of neurons. More questions? So basically this is all we need to know for the next several months. Actually you can leave now, because really the only thing that I'm going to tell you is how these things affect the dynamics. Now the dynamics is, it's not terribly complicated, but you have this, well, you have this non-linearity, which is a shame, but it will turn out to be important for many things. And if it would have been linear, then our lives would have been much easier. There's an alternative formulation that you will find in the literature. It looks something like this. Alternative combination of the rate model. So this looks something like this. Tau dvi dt is equal to minus vi of t. Plus sum over j of jij g of vj plus h I zero. So often this equation is interpreted as an equation that describes the dynamics of a membrane potential of a neuron. The difference between this formulation and this formulation is that where the nonlinearity previously we used the nonlinearity was outside the sum, and now we have the sum of nonlinearities. Well, it turns out that these formulations are in fact in some sense equivalent. And to prove that these are equivalent, questions? Is there a question? That's what I said. I will show that it is. It's not trivial. After you do it, it is, but it's not like you can put nonlinearities wherever you want and it will have no effect. I mean, in that sense, you're right. So how am I going to show it? Well, I will start from this equation. So I'm going to use this equation and look at the derivative going to look at the temporal derivative of this HI according to this standard rate model. So this is equal to, I think Else can buy better markers. So this is equal to sum over j Jij tau rj dot, right? Taking the derivative of this equation. So this is equal to sum over j of jij. Now I'm going to substitute this equation. So this would be minus Rj plus G of Hj of T. This is equal to sum over j of jij g of hj.
sum over j of j I j r j, which is almost equal to h I minus h I plus h I zero. In other words, if the dynamics of the rate follows this equation, then the dynamics of the input follows this equation. So this answers your question of the relationship between these two models. Questions? Basically, what we need now is to take these equations and study how they are affected by different inputs and by different connectivity matrices, and how these equations can help us understand the dynamics of neurons in the brain. So far, this is just an exercise, and the burden of proof is on me to show you that these equations are in fact interesting and relevant for experiments and for computation. One thing that I forgot to say is that often we will use functions, nonlinearities, which can attain a negative number. So useful nonlinearity will be a hyperbolic tangent. The physicist among you may understand why a hyperbolic tangent may be an interesting function. In that case, rate can become negative. Now this does make sense, but we can interpret the rate in these cases where we use a hyperbolic tangent as our nonlinearity as rate that is measured relative to some baseline firing rate. I'll say it again. So if we use nonlinearity, which can become non-negative, such as hyperbolic tangents, the biological interpretation of such nonlinearity would be that we are measuring the rate relative to some baseline value. Questions? If there are no more questions, we will end here, and we will start on Thursday discussing different connectivity matrices and the implications on dynamics and computation. מה יהיה בדיוק בשעה הזאת,
Thank you. בוא נחשוב רגע על HIF שהוא קבוע, כן, HIF צודקת, אם HIF הוא משתנה אז יכול להיות קצת קבוע, עכשיו תראה HIF קבוע. סכום על J, סכום על כל הנוירונים. עכשיו אני מציץ את המשוואה הזאת בתור נגזרת בזמן של RJ.
אוקיי.
אז אני מקבל את הדבר הזה.